from Ecclesiastes, beginning at the first chapter, the second verse. Vanity of vanities, says the teacher. Vanity of vanities, all is vanity. I, the teacher, when king over Israel in Jerusalem, applied my mind to seek and to search out by wisdom all that is done under heaven. It is an unhappy business that God has given to human beings to be busy with. I saw all the deeds that are done under the sun, and see, all is vanity and a chasing after wind. I hated all my toil in which I had toiled under the sun, seeing that I must leave it to those who come after me. And who knows whether they will be wise or foolish? Yet they will be master of all for which I toiled and used my wisdom under the sun. This also is vanity. So I turned and gave my heart up to despair concerning all the toil of my labors under the sun, because sometimes one who has toiled with wisdom and knowledge and skill must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity and a great evil. What do mortals get from all the toil and strain with which they toil under the sun? For all their days are full of pain, and their work is a vexation. Even at night, their minds do not rest. This also is vanity. Here endeth the lesson. Let us read the appointed selection of the Psalter in unison. O hear ye this, all ye people.
Honor it with your ears, all ye that dwell in the world. High and low, rich and poor, one with another. My mouth shall speak of wisdom, and my heart shall muse of understanding. I will incline my ear to prayer, and show my dark speech upon the heart. Wherefore should I fear in the days of evil, when wickedness at my heels, how fast and beyond battles? There be some that put their trust in their goods, and boast themselves in the multitude of their riches. But no man may deliver his brother, nor give a ransom unto God for him. For it costs more to redeem their souls, so that he must let that alone forever. That he shall live alone, and not see the grave. For he seeth that wise men also die and perish together, as well as the ignorant and foolish, and leave their riches for others. And yet they think that their houses shall continue forever, and that their dwelling places shall endure from one generation to another, and call the lands after their own names. Nevertheless, man needing honor by God, seeing he may be compared unto the beasts that perish.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Colossians, the third chapter beginning at the first verse. If you have been raised with Christ, seek the things that are above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things that are above, not on things that are on earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, is revealed, then you also will be revealed with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever in you is earthly: fornication, impurity, passion, evil desire, and greed, which is idolatry. On account of these, the wrath of God is coming on those who are disobedient. These are the ways you also once followed, when you were living that life. But now you must get rid of all such things: anger, wrath, malice, slander, and abusive language from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have stripped off the old self with its practices and have clothed yourself with the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge according to the image of its creator. In that renewal, there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave, and free, but Christ is all and in all. Here endeth the epistle.
Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
Someone in the crowd said to Jesus, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the family inheritance with me." But Jesus said to him, "Friend, who set me to be a judge or arbitrator over you?" And he said to them, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. For one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions." Then he told them a parable. The land of a rich man produced abundantly, and he thought to himself, "What should I do? For I have no place to store my crops." Then he said, I will do this. I will pull down my barns and build larger ones. And there I will store all my grain and my goods. And I will say to my soul, soul, you have ample goods laid up for many years. Relax, eat, drink, be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life is being demanded of you. And the things you have prepared, whose will they be? So it is with those who store up treasures for themselves, but are not rich toward God. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Today are with the people in Texas and in Ohio. I will not speak about that today, but ask you to remember them in your prayers and also pray that those who perpetrate such deeds may realize the evil they are doing and confess it so that others may not be led to follow them. You've heard today's scripture readings, Ecclesiastes. One who has toiled must leave all to be enjoyed by another who did not toil for it. This also is vanity, a chasing after wind. Paul to Corinthians. Put to death whatever in you is earthly. Evil desire and greed, which is idolatry, malice, slander, and abuse of language. Do not lie to one another. Luke's Gospel, Jesus said, be on your guard against all kinds of greed. One's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. The rich man said, eat, drink, and be merry. But God said to him, you fool, this very night your life will end. So, today's scriptures are thus united in one focus, the idolatry of worldly greed. Idolatry of worldly greed. We may hear in our mental background the words of hymn 573, lust of possessions worketh desolation. There is no meekness in the sons of earth. In wrath and fear, by jealousy surrounded, building proud towers, which shall not reach to heaven. Or you might hear echoes in the scriptures of the familiar Grubhub ad. I want it all, and I want it now. And the tempter's promise, yes, you can have it all now. Paul's aside here in his epistle is worthy and definitive. He talks about evils, earthly greed, and adds, which is idolatry, idolatry. Turning from the love of God, which we just read as part of the great commandment, to the worship of things, of wealth, and the admiration which earthly material success and wealth bring. You know, there's a place in our minds, your mind and mine, that does want it all now. And many people today worship their own image of worldliness. And that is idolatry. Putting something else in a place which belongs to God as we live our lives and have our attitudes. And sadly, we find new ways. We find new ways as a race to do this. And we don't recognize them for what they are. We don't think about what the advertisements on our televisions and internets are really saying to us unconsciously. We keep finding false heroes who embody false values, and we worship them with applause and chants. Yay, yay, yay. Now, there used to be a popular saying, I hope some of you remember this and keep remembering, that God made us to use things and love people, but instead we love things and use people. This doesn't just happen on the individual, personal level, but on the collective, national and international level. It is very sad and shameful that our highest elected leader, when he's not busy building proud towers, should shower malice, slander, and abusive language, condemned by St. Paul, on fellow elected representatives, and moreover tell us bold-faced lies with a straight face. But even worse, that so many of us Americans can adulate and adore such a leader because they see him as a rich, successful businessman whose fame and money can buy him anything he wants and place him above the law. That's why many people admire the wealthy and the powerful. This kind of idolatry is not new or limited to white conservatives. I remember when Adam Clayton Powell or Mayor Marion Barry basked in the sunlight of Bimini or the Bahamas when they should have been working hard for their constituents and were defended with the attitude, well, one of ours has made it and is entitled to live it up because he's got the big Benjamins now. Idolatry, vanity of vanities, all is vanity. Part of the reason there's so great a gap in wealth in this country is that many people admire the top 1% and secretly support the values and systems that make the rich richer. A dramatic example of this is the proliferation of lotteries and casinos. Let's face it, we would rather be a society where we pay for a lucky chance to suddenly strike it rich, rather than in a society where our tax dollars are used to create fair and equal educational opportunities for all children. Think of that. Did that ever strike you? We've made that choice. We don't vote to change our laws benefiting the wealthy. And we don't care about the advertisements which pander to our worst greed and worst inspired instincts. The disease of avarice is not limited to cash idolatry. It affects many other attitudes we have, both conscious and unconscious. Our sense of superiority is often connected with ideas of race, class, and wealth. We look down on those who live in rat-infested slum areas in great cities like Baltimore. We're better than those poor people, whether they are black or white. And sometimes when we chant USA or America First, what is often in the back of our minds is that we are superior to other peoples of the world because we are richer and more powerful. That's national idolatry. And we want it now. Let our grandchildren deal with the trillions and trillions of dollars in deficit spending. Let them deal with the climate change that is making much of the planet uninhabitable and our air and water poisonous. Let them deal with it. We want it all, and we want it now. And all blame can't be placed on present leadership. I remember hearing President Lyndon Johnson once say, "Don't you realize that we have what those other folks want? And if we let them, they'll try to get it and take it from us." We have a great opportunity in this nation under God to be a beacon of hope for the greed-driven world. If we can find ways to create a nation in which the interests of the whole earth are put ahead of national selfishness, a nation which puts the interest of the whole earth ahead of national ambitions, which demonstrates how from extreme diversity of race, ethnicity, religion, and ability, a fair and just society can put the welfare of all before the greed of a few. We could be a nation which lifts liberty's light high to welcome the globe's poor, tired, wretched refugees yearning to breathe free. And then, perhaps, we will more nearly and truly reflect our renewal that Paul calls us to, the renewal as true citizens of the heavenly city where there is no longer Greek and Jew, circumcised and uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave and free, but Christ is all and in all.
By the prophets,
and I believe one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole state of Christ's Church and the world. Almighty and ever living God, in thy holy word hast taught us to make prayers and supplications, and to give thanks for all men. Receive these our prayers which we offer. that they may, both by their life and doctrine, set forth thy true and lively word, and rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. And to all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that, with meek heart and due reverence, they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We beseech thee also so to rule the hearts of those who bear the authority of government in this and every land, especially Donald, our president, Lawrence, our governor, and Bernard, our mayor, that they may be led to wise decisions and right actions for the welfare and peace of the world. Open, O Lord, the eyes of all people to behold thy gracious hand in all thy works, that, rejoicing in thy whole creation, they may honor thee with their substance and be faithful stewards of thy bounty. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor those commended to our prayers, and all those who, in this transitory life, are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We pray especially for Tom, Diane, Tim, Alistair, Kemp, Claudia, Joseph, John, Joyce, Vernon, Edith, Gail, Christine, Megan, Sharon, William Andrew, Dean, Richard, Frank, Jill, Kate, Ian, Carl, Colleen, Alyssa, Sue, Donnie, Jean, Randy, Russell, Barbara, Heather, Ted, Sally, Kirsten, Abby, Tim, Arthur, Pamela, and the Church of the Advent and the Church of Grace and St. Peter's. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants departed this life in thy faith and fear, especially John and thy servants our benefactors, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy love and service, and to grant us grace so to follow the good examples of Our Lady, Blessed John, and of all thy saints, that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant these our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Let us humbly confess our sins unto Almighty God. Most merciful God, we confess we have sinned against thee in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved thee with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of thy Son, Jesus Christ,
have mercy upon us and forgive us, that we may
firm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travel and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came in.